Coming up on Prime, the road to the Oscars goes through Dallas. We'll talk movies with James Faust from the Dallas Film Society and Peter Simek from D Magazine. We are making our Oscar picks next. Hi, I'm Emily Hargrove, and welcome to Prime. So we have a very special show today. The whole show is going to be dedicated to all things Oscars. Less than a week away, the 84th Annual Academy Awards will be taking place in Hollywood. And I've got two very special guests with me today, James Faust and Peter Simek, to talk all things movies and what our picks for the Oscars are going to be. So James, Peter, thank you very much for being here.
Thanks for having us.
So before we go into the first section, which is the best picture, we're going to start with the big ones first. I just want to find out from you two, what are you hoping from the Oscars for this year?
Hoping for, I mean, I don't know.
No James Franco and Anne Hathaway.
I think one of, right, yeah.
Yeah.
I think the big split in what people are looking for is who's going to like The Tree of Life and who's going to not. Because that was the one movie that, if you look down the list, that was sort of other and big and huge and really polarizing in terms of critical and audience response. And I think it's kind of a masterpiece. So if it gets some nod, I'll be happy from it, I guess.
Well, that's good.
I don't know. I'm just hoping, as I always hope, that they get it right. I mean, just it's one of those things where there's fans rooting for certain things and critics for certain things, but finding happy mediums, and there's some movies in there that I think are happy mediums. Like Peter just said, the split between Tree of Life and everything. I have my picks. I just hope that it's a balanced Oscars and not a makeup Oscars.
And as last year, how do you think that was? Do you think that was a balanced Oscars or a makeup Oscars? Cast your mind back.
Trying to think. I'd say balanced, with the exception of James Franco. I think I enjoyed pretty much everything. I mean, oh my gosh. There were no surprises to me last year.
So, but this year, you think that there could be?
There has to be.
Well, we've got 9 Best Picture nominations. And as you say, from The Tree of Life through to the more consumer-friendly, I suppose, Descendants, Moneyball, they're a lot more consumer-friendly than The Tree of Life.
I think anything's more consumer-friendly than The Tree of Life.
that's true. So let's have a think about the ones. I mean, for me, the one that outshines all of them, the ones that I've seen, is The Artist. And I don't know, is that because, I just thought it was utterly glorious in every way. And I was going in there expecting not to be wowed by it and thinking, how am I going to sit through an hour, 40 minutes of a silent film? And really, do I have to sit through a silent film? Was how I went into it, and I came out just saying, no, I want more, I want more. So, I mean, that to me, we'll watch a clip of that in a moment, but what do you two think about The Artist?
I thought it was great. I mean, it's funny, it's charming. Like you said, I think it was really bold to bring a movie like that to a contemporary audience to see if it could play, and it works. And what I liked about it is that it was it's a very funny, it's very amusing kind of great love story, but it doesn't really hold back on its sort of dramatic oomph, and it really, that character you're really in by the end of it, and it's a great, hopefully a good gateway too to rediscovering a lot of silent film classics and that kind of thing.
Yeah, I hope so too. Well, let's see if we can take a look at The Artist. Do you think this will mark a return back to to silent movies and people trying to enter into that? Every 5 years or so, there's something that's very fashionable. And do you think that this will go back to people saying, okay, we're going to have a slew of silent movies now, or do you think this will be a special one-off?
It's a one-off.
You think so?
I don't think it'll be hard to recreate what the best thing about The Artist for me was that it's the very best in what film can be. And I don't think to try to recreate it it'd be a travesty. And I think it would not, unless you did like the action hero and there was no sound, just explosions. I mean, I don't think it would work any other way, because you would just be always compared to The Artist. oh, they're just ripping it out. I can't imagine a slew of these coming, but yeah, I think it's a one-off.
You think so?
I mean, the thing about it is it's the silent aspect of it is part of the novelty of the film. So as much as it's a film that's silent, it's also a film about silent films. And so it'd be hard to have derivatives of that, because the one way it plays to the contemporary audience is because it keeps winking about its self-consciousness that it is this silent film. But I think if you think of it alongside Hugo, the Martin Scorsese film, mm-hmm. Entry of Life, it's interesting that there are these three films that are dealing with storytelling as a visual medium and trying to kind of use that to its full power. I don't know if that has, if it's too much of a stretch to make connections to various other media developments and that kind of thing, to say why are a lot of directors thinking about what it is about movies, and specifically the movie in a movie theater, that is sort of unique to it. But all three, Scorsese's sort of nostalgic look back at Georges Méliès and his silent films, The Artist, which is a silent film, and then Terrence Malick, who's basically making something that is trying to push the medium of cinema into places it's never been before. I think that may be a trend that you could look for.
That's, I like that. That nostalgic look back. I mean, the Tree of Life is, I've only seen the clips of it, but from just the clips, we'll take a look at the clip next, but the clips of it itself, I mean, it's just so ethereal and out there, and then it brings into to Brad Pitt's character and his son, and I mean, to me, it looks fascinating, but that is obviously your favorite.
Yeah. And it's funny, I think if you took the Brad Pitt segment and pulled it out, and it's probably 40 minutes to an hour of the movie, and put that in the live action shorts, it'd probably be a front runner. But it's what's really polarizing is the complete bracketing of that in what is sort of typical for Malick, this very dense philosophic sort of meditation on all things that usually don't get play in movies. Yeah. Grace, life, death, all these things that are very heavy for the contemporary cinema.
Well, do you think if it wasn't Malick, would it have got out there in the same way if it had been an unknown director?
You could probably speak to that.
I don't think anybody else could have done it. And I hate to say that, but this is a very, is Malickian a word? I mean, can you give me that?
It's now creative.
it's a film school film, in essence, and where you break things down. Like, a few directors could get something like this done. I mean, you'd have to have a certain level of respect and juice in the studio system to make this movie. So I don't see how, especially at a level with a Brad Pitt or Sean Penn, I don't think how anyone else could have made this movie without being on that level. Like, if Robert Zemeckis had done Tree of Life, I mean, it's just got as much digital. I mean, the history of the world might be a little different at the beginning, but, you know, might be a Marty McFly in it, but it's still, I don't think anybody else could have done that film.
You think so? Well, let's take a quick look at the Tree of Life. James, you've just said that this is the best film ever made in Texas.
Yeah.
Will you stand by that? As other Texas filmmakers will be saying to you, James Faust.
Actually, you know what, I have to say yes. Going back, I love Lone Star. I mean, it's one of the things I love. But that film, we were just talking about the trees, and I just think it's just a beautiful film, and the fact that, you know, it was shot here and from, I just love it. I can't imagine. I'm racking my head right now going through, you said Bottle Rocket, that's cool, but no.
Being slightly facetious.
I can't think of another film that actually sort of glorifies and examines Texas like better than that thing right there.
Well, I have got to watch it. So That's one Brad Pitt film. The other Brad Pitt film, obviously, is Moneyball.
Moneyball!
I was, for me, Moneyball, I started watching it at 9:15, a midweek night, which for me is normally 10 minutes in, I'm fast asleep, and it kept me wide awake until 11:30, which is quite a feat for me. But for you two, I know you've watched films all night and all day, but that I really enjoyed it, but I don't think that it will shine like some of the others will. What do you two think of Moneyball?
The best studio film on that list,
you think
in
so?
My opinion, of the Oscars. I had a chance to see that back in September. That was amazing. I thought the best I've seen from Brad Pitt in a long time. Mm-hmm. I actually read the book. It's a little different. I remember when the story actually happened. I love the concept. I think it's the of all the studio films that are out there, it made my top five of the year. It's just the best studio Oscar film I've seen. Oh my God, I don't know, since I say Schindler's List. I hate to be that big about it, but I just really enjoyed. I love baseball, and I love a story like this. And you know, I've got a crush on Brad Pitt from way back, and it's awesome.
What do you think, Peter?
Well, I agree. I really enjoy the movie. The script is fantastic.
Steve Zalian, yeah.
As a sports movie, I think it's really great because it's a movie that, like, there's another movie that's nominated for a documentary award, Undefeated, mm-hmm. and they're similar insofar as they both are sports movies that are about so much more and sort of teach you how sports can be about, you know, what is it about sports that becomes so captivating to us and the essential dramas and all the bit players. Jonah Hill, I don't know if that's an Oscar-worthy performance, but, you know,
he's
very enjoyable in it. Philip Seymour Hoffman is good in it. It's great characters all around.
Yeah, I thought it was I really enjoyed it. And the other one that I really enjoyed was The Descendants, mm-hmm. although it was slightly depressing. But but it was not a very great date night movie for me and my husband. We came out just going, oh gosh, let's. But I thought it was I did thoroughly enjoy it. What do you both think of The Descendants?
You know, I initially was slightly underwhelmed by it, and I went back and watched it again. And I think what turned me off initially is it's somewhat of an uneven movie. I think the last act, so to speak, is really strong, and I think even Clooney's performance kind of picks up. The problem I've had with some of the beginnings of it is there's a lot that's done in overdub. You don't really know who this character is, and you don't know him before this sort of tragedy happens, and so it's a little hard to penetrate into exactly where he stands. I think it takes a good hour to finally figure out, okay, I have a grasp on who this character is supposed to be and what this world is, because that's the thing with Alexander Payne is he works with a lot of sort of satiric types, and if you go expecting sort of straight drama, you're going to get sort of characters that are a little more rounded around the edges, a little more silhouette-y and a little more goofy, which makes his stuff really appealing.
But and that must have been intentional, though, for Alexander Payne to do that, because, I mean, that's exactly what I felt. I went in there and in just, as you say, penetrating into Clooney's character was something that it was like, oh, who is he? Right. And then, yes, and the last 30 minutes or so were really strong. I came out bored.
Yeah, like you said, the overdub, he tells you who he is so much, and you're not really discovering it as much as I do this, and I'm in Hawaii, and then he just sort of drones on, and I thought Clooney was the best thing about the film, but also said he's sort of just like a caricature. I never really had any depth, because he explains everything about him without you having to figure things out. Mm-hmm. It's just so laid out for you, and Alexander Payne talked about how he likes quiet adult films, as he likes things that are about that people talking. And I mean, this was quiet, and this was, you know, an adult story, but I just never connected. I never had a sense of peril or tragedy, even though there's tragic things happening. I think it's a well done film, but it's certainly not, it didn't make any top five for me mm-hmm. for the entire year. And I saw it twice as well.
Yeah.
Go on.
Well, there are little moments that I think Payne really shows his talent, and these little punctuated things like that. I remember there's a very memorable shot of his wife who is in a coma, her face when they've taken her off life support. Mm. And Clooney's face at a number of times. I think the best part of his performance is how everything kind of slowly builds this weight on his shoulders, and it kind of works him down, and he doesn't overplay that. He really holds it in, and there's these moments where you just see his face that work really well. And I think towards the end it really becomes this really subtle play of juxtapositions between the lightness and really adult material.
Yeah.
Do you think best actor for Clooney for that?
I think he has kind of the star power going for him, mm-hmm, which always is a factor in the Oscars, but yeah. I don't know if I'd put it as my favorite. I think it's a little uneven.
Yeah, I think he's not my pick, but I think he's going to win.
You think so?
Yeah.
He didn't win Best Actor at the Golden Globes, though, did he?
Yes, he...
Oh, he did?
He did. I think.
I'm just trying to think back.
I think he did.
I know at, I know at the BAFTAs that Jean Dujardin won for The Artist.
That would be awesome.
So,
that would be an amazing feat.
That would be, yeah. So now, going on to a couple of the others, Spielberg and Warhorse. Mm-hmm. eyebrow raises.
I had a very, almost, you know, I like Spielberg. There's a lot of his films that, you know, especially as a kid, I mean, Raiders of the Lost Ark, all the way to, you know, a lot of his newer stuff. I really love Munich, I thought was really solid. Warhorse, I felt almost manipulated by, and it made me angry at first, and I've sort of softened to it. But I thought there was a lot of holes in terms of personifying the horse. First of all, the horse's name is Joey. I don't know about you, but it seems like the worst horse name in any movie. And I'm from New York, so I'm hearing the whole time, "Hey, Joey the horse, come on, let's get in the trenches." But
jumped his fence.
But I thought, I guess you're trying to tell the horse, the story connected to the horse, but it's really about the characters. It felt very uncentered. And then the cinematography, which is so beautiful, and a lot of the appeal, again, is another one of these throwback movies like The Artist that's looking back to kind of another era of cinema, doing it really well. But I thought it was pushing for emotion where emotion didn't actually exist in the movie, and I thought that was slightly manipulative and didn't really enjoy it.
It's an ABC sort of, meaning these are the parts you need to make a Spielberg film, and it's almost like he parodied himself. Mm-hmm. It's so large and so, all the sweeping shots, and you have characters and actors that you might not know bringing new people in, and I'm a Spielbergaholic. I love everything, but I hated that horse most of the movie. If I looked at that eye one more time, and that horse is like, it was so huge. I thought, wow. And at times, the horse was the best actor in the film, mm-hmm. And that was weird. I think Warhorse is like, is it a payback? Well, why is it Warhorse here? Is it like, oh, we're gonna do 10-10, so we're gonna give you Warhorse? And I was wondering, is it's really tailor-made? It's one of those films you look at, other films are made about how you make an Oscar film. I mean, most of the time you see how you make an Oscar film, what do you do? Give me some war, throw some Nazis, mm-hmm, in there, maybe throw it in Britain,
yeah, and then all of a sudden,
you got a nomination, King's Speech. So, I mean...
Oh, I love the King's Speech, but...
Of course you do.
I'm so British. Your favorite one, Midnight in Paris.
Midnight in Paris. I sort of cooled on Woody Allen the last 10 or so years. Sort of thinking he's just making movies to appease himself, and this movie was a throwback to what I've always liked about music, about Woody Allen, the things that, like, something you'd see in Bananas, or Purple Rose of Cairo, or Zelig, these sort of magical realism of something that exists in a you know, standard place. And like, I'm gonna walk over here, and all of a sudden I'm in 1839, and I just, that whole concept. And then being, you know, loving film so much and going through film school and seeing him and studying that period, and he's sitting, there's a scene where they're sitting next to Man Ray, and I'm thinking, oh my, do you know who these people are? These are these, oh, they're Dada artists. And I just really enjoyed that history and the lesson in that film, which is actually a tale and a lesson where people stand up and go, wow, I don't want, everybody hasn't seen the film, but it's everything about that film was a perfect Woody Allen. And then always you have somebody who's playing Woody Allen, mm-hmm, in the movie. If he's not in the movie, who's the best Woody Allen? At one point, I thought it was John Cusack Danny Rose, but the John Cusack performance. I think Owen Wilson does a really, really good Southern Woody Allen.
Yeah, he
in
did.
This film.
Owen Wilson was very good in it. Another Dallas boy. Yeah. Just hark back to Dallas again. And so we've just got a short length of time left just to touch on the others, The Help and Hugo and Extremely Loud and Incredibly Close. In the last minute, what do you think between those three such different ones? Hugo is another huge, that's a big studio movie.
Yeah.
The Help.
I think those three, in terms of who's going to get the nod, maybe I'll eat my words on Hugo, but they're definitely bringing up the rear of the pack. Extremely Loud, Incredibly Close, I thought is really punching above its weight in this category. I think the New York Times article put it, as best as I heard, as sort of taking 9/11 and treating it as kitsch. There's something very sort of softly sentimental about it that feels unmatched the material itself. And The Help was a huge hit, and everyone loved it, and I watched and I laughed all the way through. But it left a tone, I felt, that it really kind of irked me that, you know, it's one of these movies that it it puts the audience in too comfortable a moral position for the conversation that's trying to have, so that you're very easily on the side of the quote-unquote good guys without any sort of implication in what is really an American story that still needs to be explored again and again and again.
Well, what we'll do, when we come back after the break, we'll get James and Peter's, what they think their final picks are going to be for the best picture, and then we'll touch upon documentaries, so stay with us. Back to Prime. So I am here with James Faust and Peter Simek, and we are talking Oscars. So let's touch upon the documentary category, and then after that we're going to go through what you think the picks are for each of the categories to wrap up. So documentaries.
Very strong pool. I mean, I think it's a fantastic time for documentaries, and not to give the fest a plug, but I mean, what's exciting about, you know, any festival in town or out of town, I mean, it seems like there's just a glut of great documentaries, and one of the nominated ones played at last year's festival.
If a Tree Falls.
Yeah.
But Undefeated is a story about a North Memphis football team. Like I mentioned before, a great sports movie, but really just about it. It actually plays well with a movie that I think should be in this category too, which is Steve James's The Interrupters.
Oh,
which
I love that.
They both deal with cycles of violence and cycles of poverty and all these sort of issues of the inner city in such nuanced and interesting and just, you know, kind of tear-jerking ways. And another great one that's in the list is Helen Back Again, which I think is one of the great, with Restrepo, one of the best war documentaries of the last few years. And what it does is it takes clips of this one soldier in Iraq, a Marine, as well as him back in his hometown, and intercuts them in a way that you know isn't manipulative in terms of the trying to get an emotional effect out of you, but really trying to think through what the impact of war is on the homeland, this very sort of nuanced Deer Hunter kind of way. It's a beautiful movie.
Yeah, I've seen the clips of that, and it looks really amazing. The Interrupters, I'm surprised, wasn't nominated.
Yeah, we were too. I mean, that was one of my favorite films of the year, period, last year. And the fact that we had Steve James out at the festival last year, and such a powerful story, and he pours so much of his life into these films, and it's so intricate that something that's so important didn't make it. That's where we were talking earlier about some of the other documentary nominations. Pina, the Wim Wenders film, it's one of those films that I thought, wow, the rest of these films, talking about Helen Back, about the war, If a Tree Falls is an environmental piece about this particular organization who have done what they do and how they've been persecuted. Paradise Lost 3, I mean, about the West Memphis kids. I mean, you're thinking, wow, then Undefeated, and then you throw Pina in this sort of video art piece that is lovely to look at and beautiful, and we talked about sort of a discussion on looking at dance a different way and understanding dance, but it sort of sticks out like the thumb on the hand for me for documentaries, because I think this is a strong pool. Paradise Lost 3, thing I didn't really want to get involved in, and I thought, wow, Joe Berlinger also came to the festival a few years ago. Except for the fact that there is a fourth movie now, was a great ending to the story in a way before the narrative comes out, and I can only echo everything you said about Undefeated. That movie, it's great. The great thing about a documentary, when you find a great narrative through line that would make a great a narrative feature, and Undefeated is a real story and a true story and has all of that right in it. So
do you think that's going to be the documentary winner?
I wouldn't be surprised. I think one of the coach, I mean, is one of the best characters that is in the movies this year.
And you can't write that guy.
So really, it's fantastic. Just to give a little show of support for Pina, I think it fits in with this whole other thing we were talking about with thinking about what is film as a visual medium and where does it stand today. And Wim Wenders using 3D technology like his colleague Werner Herzog did for another great documentary that could be on this list, Cave of Forgotten Dreams. I think it may have qualified a year before. But thinking about how to rethink of what a movie can be and trying to use cinema language to talk about dance language, I found it a very powerful movie, though it does stick out because it isn't what you expect from a documentary. I don't know if it's fair to call it a documentary. It's almost something else, but it's definitely one to see.
But don't you think that Pina will be one of those films that will be studied in radio, film, TV schools throughout the nation?
People should see it. I mean, there's no doubt. It's like kind of like War Horse in a way, where, like I said, War Horse is visually arresting. This is visually, life, I think, because you're in for Pina and you're watching it like, oh, especially, I didn't see it in 3D, actually.
Yeah, me neither.
Okay.
Full disclosure.
So you think Undefeated for documentary, do you agree?
That's my gut, but I think that If a Tree Falls will win that. I think we're moving into a world. I think Paradise Lost seems like a thing, but I think If a Tree Falls, I think there's an environmental thing happening. There's people, and I've been wrong on documentary every year for the last 5 years. So.
And they were. And If a Tree Falls won the Audience Award at Dallas International.
It won the Environmental Award.
Environmental Award,
and it finished really close to an Audience Award, actually.
It did.
Yeah.
So okay, so going through all of the nominees, then Best Picture, Peter.
Best feature, I got a Tree of Life.
It's just so huge. That's what you want to win, but do you think it will win?
That's what I want to win.
That's what you want to win. Okay. I mean, well, that's good. James?
If we're going with what I want to win, I'd have to say Midnight in Paris.
And if I go with what I want to win, it would be The Artist.
But that's what I think will win. I think
The Artist. Yes, they cleaned up the BAFTAs, so I'd be surprised if they didn't clean up the Oscars in one way or the other. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Best Actor in a leading role.
Gary Oldman. Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy, we haven't brought up yet. Gary Oldman finally gets an Oscar nomination. But if you think of a single performance that really has all of the weight and all the nuance, and it's so tight-lipped, and there's a scene with a lighter. I mean, it's the only moment in a movie where a single actor has just completely, pulled me in and put me under the water. It's just an amazing, amazing performance.
Yeah, I love Gary Oldman. And what about
George Clooney? He's my pick, and as much as I sort of, have dissent about The Descendants, I thought that if there's one thing about that film, from just everything he does without saying anything, every facial expression on him, he carries and pulls that film through. George Clooney.
George. Okay, and the actress in a leading role?
This one's a hard one. I'm not super excited. If I had to pick who's gonna get it, I would probably say Glenn Close or Michelle Williams. I know the Oscars likes to pick actors and actresses who are doing imitations of real characters. Think of Ray Charles a few years ago with Jamie Foxx. But I think it's probably between Michelle Williams and Glenn Close. But
Glenn Close, and not Meryl Streep?
No.
The Iron Lady?
No, sorry to you.
She's my girl.
I know, but
and I could talk to you two all day, and I can't believe that we're running out of time. We haven't even gone through all of our best picks. But James, Peter, thank you both so much for being here.
Thanks
for
having me.
Join us next week in the show Active Living, and I will see you next time. Thank you so much for joining us. Bye-bye.